Hello everyone, hello YouTube, this is Felipe, o gato de salto, and oh my gosh, have I missed you! Ah! First of all, let me apologize for being away for so long. You know, 2020 was a very challenging year also for me, and I don't know, I had so many other things that I had to take care of because they were falling apart that unfortunately my YouTube channel was neglected, but I am back in 2021 and I promise I have a lot of nice interesting things to tell you, and I can't wait to share everything that I've learned not only in the past year but also throughout my entire time in the carnival and in this amazing samba world. So today, I want to talk to you about something very important that many sambistas don't really know. There's not a lot of information out there, and you kind of need to be an insider to know more about candomblé. Now, candomblé is an Afro-Brazilian religion. So when we were in Brazil, things started to develop with the knowledge and the basis of philosophy and religion that those people who were enslaved brought with them to the country. So we had different religions developing and emerging, and among these religions there are two religions that I consider to be more influential and that definitely influence everything you can possibly think within the samba world, within carnival, within the parades, the enredos, the songs, the beating of the drums and everything. These two religions are candomblé and umbanda. I am not a religion expert. I am not trying to convert you. I'm not trying to tell you that this is the right way. This is just a light research that I did. I will leave my sources in the description box, so I could actually just help people like you who is not Brazilian, who is interested in samba. So this video is sort of a knowledge transfer for international sambistas who are constantly exposed to Afro-Brazilian subjects and themes and not necessarily understand. They probably think, oh, I know, it's something about Orisha, right? But what is it? So in order to get that far, I need to start from the very beginning, and this is the very beginning. Candomblé is over 5,000 years old, so you can't just, you know, wrap it up in a 10-minute YouTube video. So the candomblé religion is a religion that was imported to Brazil with the people who were enslaved, and mostly from a part of Africa that is, I don't actually know what the region is called, but the people who lived in this region is called the Yoruba people, and that Yoruba consists of many different tribes and many different folk groups, and it is also a language, Yoruba. So when you are in Rio, when you are in carnival, you are constantly exposed to words that are in Yoruba language. So the candomblé is the religion, the Afro-Brazilian religion, that tries to rescue those African roots and really stay as loyal as possible to how things were done back in Africa. Afro-religions, Afro-culture, Afro-history has not been passed on by writing. So most of the stories, the myths behind the religion that I'm going to introduce to you people, were passed on through the generations orally. So there's no written record, and for this reason, there are many, many different versions of the same story. So it's hard to find, it's hard to say it's done like this, this means this, because it, you know, most of the meaning and of the, you know, how things happened were lost in time and conveyed by orally. This is very important for you to understand the difference to the other religion, which is Umbanda. Candomblé is really, it's the more orthodox way, if you can put it this way, is the more orthodox way of seeing this entire creation of the world through the orishas, and this candomblé is much more loyal, or at least to tradition. And since I'm talking about religion, I would like to remind you that this is the religion of many, many Brazilians and many, many people across the world. So we have to be very respectful. I'm really trying to do my best here, just conveying knowledge. So I ask permission to all the orishas, Ishu as well, to help me carry and convey this information to you. I do not want to offend anybody here. So the Candomblé religion believes that there was one creator at first. So Olorun, for example, it's an orisha, and I will be talking about the orishas in a different video as well. But this this being, this supreme god, basically created the world and the orishas, which were sort of different aspects of himself. Okay, now the orishas within the Candomblé religion are gods. They are different gods, just like the Greek pantheon or the Roman pantheon. And these gods, they are in a way also very human. They have very much human similarities to what we feel like. Sometimes they fall in love with one another, they are jealous, they fight, they get offended. So these gods are very much like ourselves. And these gods, they want to be venerated just like any other gods in different pantheons. So they are venerated through music and dance and offerings and many other things, like especially the serving of foods that has to be prepared in a very, very specific way. This is how you venerate the orishas and the gods and ask them for their blessings. Every orisha is kind of responsible for a different sector of life. We are also, as people, as humans, we have orishas guiding us through life as well. So your personality, just like an astrological sign, is also defined by orishas. So because they want to be venerated, and Candomblé prefers to stay through to how things were done back in Africa, they are the religion that takes animal sacrifice and blood. So if you have, you know, got to know a little bit more of Afro-Brazilian religions, you probably heard of the word macumba, or if you are Brazilian, you know what I'm talking about, and people associate that with voodoo magic, associate that with animal sacrifice and the devil, you know, because the Catholic Church came and said that everything is wrong and forbidden. And I'll just remind you to keep an open mind. They are all about tradition, so they want to stay true to how things were done back then. And of course, it's no need to say, even in some Brazilian tribes, I am sure that animal sacrifice is just the way things are done. So Candomblé, up to today, they still use animal sacrifice. But don't go out there, you know, thinking that Candomblé is horrible, it's a horrible religion. No, they use every single part of the animal that they sacrifice. So the blood is used, the meat is used, and whatever the leather, like the fur or the skin to make leather, or the feathers, depending if it's a bird, things are used. Nothing is supposed to go to waste. They respect and they recognize that whatever life that they are offering to those gods is a life, is a valuable life. Now, another very important characteristic is for you to understand that this is again focused on the way the things were done in Africa before Brazil. So there's no Catholic saints or different spirits or different entities that are within the Candomblé. So Candomblé is really much more about centering and the tradition. It's a very hierarchic religion. You have the priest and the priestesses, and they, the hierarchy within the house of cult, where like the terreiro, is very, very strict. They're very strict about what can be worn and the colors can be worn, which day of the week they can be worn, what food is cooked, what those people who are part of their religions and of them, of their group, of that house, what they're allowed to do, what they're not. So Candomblé is very, very strict. And another important aspect of Candomblé is how the advice is given and taken from the gods, how men and mankind, womankind, everything in between kind, and the gods communicate. And that's through Buzius, it's those little shells. I think they're called cowries. It's sort of a sea mollusk, like a sea slug, and they come in little round shells. Sometimes you might have seen those in costumes. So that's an oracle that is used for the communication in Candomblé. Another interesting fact about Candomblé is that it's really, there's no society that is basically supporting them. So it's very common that priests or priestesses, they charge for their services, either if it's for an oracle consultation or indeed a ritual or an offering. They might also charge a symbolic value, or they might charge a donation of some kind, but they charge. Another interesting aspect that you probably might have seen, that it's within Candomblé religion, is the incorporation of Orishas. So basically, when you have a psychic, a medium, right? So someone who is directly connected and very sensitive and able to incorporate spirits. In Candomblé, there is no spirits incorporation, it's the own Orisha, it's the Orisha, him or herself, itself in some cases, that manifests him, herself, itself through the body of that person. So the incorporation within Candomblé is the incorporation of Orishas, the gods themselves. I've had an experience with Candomblé before. I remember basically almost all of the years that I've been going to Carnival in Rio, I've been taken by a good friend to a Candomblé priest, and I have learned a lot. It was a very interesting experience for me. When I got there, I could see the different offerings. I have experienced animal sacrifice, which was for me at that time very shocking, but I was able to understand what that was about and what was going on. I have had the oracle thrown for me, and I obtained amazing information. I was also assigned an Orisha and a saint, and I got cleansed. I got a cleansing ritual that was performed. I remember I had to bathe in a specific bath that was already prepared for me with different herbs, and I had to bathe from the top of my head down. And after the ritual was performed, which consisted on passing an egg, not broken, all over my body to absorb the negative energies, it was the moment that when I was starting my career, there was a lot of jealousy involved. So, and they could see that. They were like, you have to be careful. So I did the ritual, and I remember after, when I took that bath, like that shower of herbal water, I don't think I have ever experienced anything like it. It was just like getting so much lighter. It's like someone just took a heavy backpack off me, and I could just feel so much lighter. It was amazing. So I'm very, very positively impressed. Also the oracle situation, it was my contact to this religion became more and more often and intense since I started going to Rio for Carnival. And I don't regret it. I'm actually falling more and more in love with the Afro religions, that are really big parts of Brazilian society anyway. I'm not saying they're well seen. There's a lot of prejudice. There's a lot of fear. There's a lot of misconception and misunderstanding within the Brazilian society about this Afro-Brazilian religions, Candomblé, Umbanda. There's a third word, Kimbanda, as well. I will not be going into that. But it's very, for me, it's very interesting to see how, to learn more about this religion, because of course, since I grew up in Brazil, I was exposed to it, but rather as being something wrong and some kind of black magic from the devil. But, and now that I'm being more exposed to it, I'm falling in love. So I recommend you to inform yourself more about this religion if you're interested. I will try to leave as many descriptions and links in the description box of this video, so you can inform yourself more about the Candomblé. But I can promise you there are still more videos coming about this. We are talking about Umbanda next week. I'm also introducing you to the Orishas and showing where they are present within the carnival. So there's a lot of exciting things coming, and I'm happy to be back. So if you enjoyed this video, this short introduction, leave your thumbs up. If you haven't yet, please subscribe to the channel. This is very important, people. I don't get funded, I don't get money, I don't get anything. At least I want to know that someone is watching my videos. Takes a lot of time, you know, first getting this done and then being here and talking to the camera, editing. So please support me, send this channel to all of your friends, and we'll keep exploring the different and amazing areas of our beloved Samba world. So take care and see you next time. Bye.